performance arena, and then present results, experimental results from six trials, three with phytogenics and three with probiotics. So let's start by defining gut performance, just to help us go along this presentation. We could say that gut performance is a term that has been coined to highlight the link between zootechnical or animal performance, if you prefer, and optimal gut function and health. Or better, optimal gut function and health with zootechnical performance. Which brings us to the next question, which is, how can an optimal gut function and health be defined and captured in terms of measuring and determining reliable biomarkers, biological responses that we can reliably determine? And this is a very difficult exercise to do at this time. However, with the progress of scientific knowledge, we have now identified four major components of the gut ecosystem that they continuously interact. And we see, for example, diet, gut microbiota, as it was mentioned before by the previous speaker, gut mucosa status and immune response or inflammation management, that the interaction of these factors will determine what the gut function and health will be like. It is worth mentioning that, as you are aware, these components are multi-element components. So this actually raises this gut complexity. And so if we try to define the optimal gut function and health, we would say that this could be a state where the dynamic and continuously interacting component of the gut ecosystem are fine-tuned, they are aligned, and they reach an equilibrium which actually result in enhanced nutrient utilization, in elimination of pathogens, host detoxification, and inflammation management. If all these are aligned, then we can talk about gut performance, and then, of course, it makes sense that in that case, more nutrients become available for production purposes, and then we immediately link gut performance with animal performance. Now, as you all aware, gut performance is a very hot topic, especially if we take into account the increasing worldwide pressure for removal of antibiotics from animal nutrition, which could create problems. And therefore, we need suitable strategies or combination of strategies to counteract the problems that will occur. This would include good farming practices, genetic selection of resistant animals, and application of suitable bioactive feed additives, which actually are additives which can elicit a direct or indirect biological response that could help this alignment and fine-tuning of the gut components to reach, to achieve gut performance, which the term also should include cost-effectiveness, safety, and the environmental friendly approach. Examples could include, from the feed additives that you know, enzymes, mycotoxin binders, prebiotic, organic acid, phytogenics, and probiotics. So I will now proceed by showing some results of the experimental trials that we have done in our facilities. And I will start with the phytogenic trials. Just to give a brief definition about phytogenics, the term refers to the utilized parts of aromatic plants, herbs, spices, fruits, and their extracts, such as, for example, carvacrol, thymol, anethol, and so on. Just stay with me on this slide because I will be talking about these trials. I have tried to present them in a tabular form so that perhaps it will be more easy for you to follow. Let's start with the first trial, where three phytogenic inclusion levels have been tested against a negative control, that there was no phytogenic, and against an antimicrobial growth promoter group. The phytogenic used in this trial was based in carvacrol, anethol, and limonene as the main active ingredients. Trials 2 and 3 are actually phytogenic inclusion at two inclusion levels, 150 milligrams per kilogram and 150. The difference between the trial is that one trial is based on maize and the other on wheat as the cereal used. And the phytogenic used was based on menthol and anethol. So two different phytogenics, three trials. And starting with the results, starting first of all from the performance results. In the first trial where we had the three inclusion levels, we noticed that we determined a significant effect on the feed conversion ratio in inclusion levels 2 and 3, which is 125 ppm and 250 ppm of the particular phytogenic. And the response to this response was not different from the microbial growth promoter group. In the other two trials that we used the phytogenic based on menthol, in the maize diets, we recorded an improvement on overall body weight gain. The columns represent the numbers. They are relative to the control. The control is taken as 100%, and here is the increase. And on wheat-based diets, we had a reduction in feed intake, which, since the overall body weight gain was not significantly affected, it resulted in an improvement in the feed conversion ratio, especially for the group with 100 milligrams per kilogram inclusion level. To all these trials, we have also conducted at the same time digestibility studies. And we have shown that the phytogenics can beneficially affect the available dietary energy to the birds. Next, other parameters that have been determined refer to the modulation of caecal microbiota composition, where we have seen that phytogenic inclusion has increased lactobacillus and bifidobacterium levels in the cica of the birds. And actually, there is, if you take these treatments, there is a linear pattern of increase with phytogenic inclusion level for both groups. Another interesting determination was the we isolated mucus and we studied the mucin composition and especially the monomers that comprise the mucin molecule. Perhaps in this state I should say that we know that mucus is the main lubricant that protects the intestinal epithelium from luminal threats, and that mucin is the main component of mucus, which is actually a glycoprotein which is glycosylated with these monomers, N-acetyl glucosamine, N-acetyl galactosamine, galactose, mannose, fucose, and N-acetyl neuraminic acid, which is known as sialic acid. In this trial, we noticed that duodenal mucin at 14-day-old broilers was actually increased. The molar ratio of mannose was increased with the phytogenic inclusion level, and galactose was increased in the ileum. Now, if we consider that the human milk, which has a very strong antipathogenic function for newborn infants, comprises oligosaccharides that consist from these molecules, this raises the next question, what these changes might imply for potential antipathogenic function. This is not known, so we have to study it more. By looking now at the gene which encodes mucin production in the intestine of the broilers, in the trial where we did maize, the maize trial, we've seen that there is an increase in the expression of the MUC2 gene, a significant increase for the M100 concentration, and also there is an increase in the gene expression of the immunoglobulin A. Now, these patterns, and I refer to patterns because they are trends, they are not significant, and the differences are not significant at the 0.05 value, but there are strong trends show that phytogenic inclusion reduces expression of inflammatory cytokines and factors in spleen of broilers. So we are talking about a systemic effect that is monitored, but is a trend. But it's characteristic trend, because I want to show you the next slide, which shows what happens to the total antioxidant capacity of broiler plasma. Differences here are significant, and there are very strong effects that grow as we add more phytogenic into the diet. And also, this is also seen to the wheat-based diets with even stronger effect. And finally, in meat, when it was analyzed for total antioxidant capacity, we have seen also an increase in the meat total antioxidant capacity with phytogenic inclusion. So to summarize, irrespective of the patterns that I have shown you, we could say that phytogenics, apart from the positive effect that they may have in performance, there is strong indications of positive effects on energy sparing and basically making more energy available for the bird. They have positive effects on modulation of caecal microbiota. And then we see some interesting patterns that are worth of further investigation in terms of mucin composition, immunoglobulin A production, expression of mucin genes, anti-inflammatory genes, and increases in total antioxidant capacity, which is good signs regarding to the growth performance puzzle that we try to fit. Then I will proceed with the probiotic studies. Professor Manfreda before gave the definition of probiotics, so we all know that probiotics have been defined as live microbial supplements that affect beneficially the gut ecology. Lactobacillus, bifidobacterium, enterococcus, streptococcus are characteristic, these first groups mainly found in most, in many probiotics available. We can talk about yeasts and also Bacillus probiotics. Main effects, reduction of pathogens, enhancement of gut barrier function through the mechanisms that were described by the previous speaker, so I'm not going to say more. We also should not forget that as live microbes, they contribute to digestion since they are producing enzymes themselves. The three trials now that I'm going to present the results are again in a similar style like the phytogenics I did before. Three inclusion levels, log 10 CFU per kilogram, log 9 CFU per kilogram, and log 10 CFU per kilogram. Five species probiotic measured against a negative control and a positive control that contains antimicrobial growth promoter. Another trial with mixed-sex broilers. I forgot to tell you that the previous trials, and all of them apart from this one, are on male broilers. This one is on mixed broilers. Two inclusion levels, log 10, log 8 and log 9, with three species probiotic. And then the last trial that I'm going to talk about is a trial which the probiotic has been used in two versions. One was the live version, and the other was a heat inactivated version. Basically, we tried to kill the live probiotic by heat treatment. And another interesting aspect of the study is that both forms, the VIP, the viable, and the inactivated NP forms, were combined or not with an antimicrobial growth promoter, which is denoted by A. So we have control, no probiotics, control plus antimicrobial growth promoter, viable, viable plus antimicrobial growth promoter, and inactive, and inactivated plus antimicrobial growth promoter. In this trial, the inclusion level of the probiotic was fixed at the log 8 CFU per kilogram. In the first study, we noticed that probiotic inclusion level is very important to the response, to the growth performance response. And the study showed that the low inclusion level, the log 8 CFU per kilogram, gave significant response comparing to the control. This response was not different from the antimicrobial growth promoter, but we also, apart from the overall body weight gain, had changes in the overall feed conversion ratio. Again, the best feed conversion ratio was on the log 8 CFU per kilogram. And then we computed an index which is called European Production Efficiency Index that takes into account body weight gain, feed conversion ratio, final body weight, days that the trial lasted. And as it is expected by the overall body weight gain and the feed conversion ratio, we had a significant increase in this that was not different from the control, but it differed from the positive control, but it differed from the negative control and the other probiotic groups. So let's keep performance log 8 CFU per kilogram to go for the digestibility study where the improvement in the available dietary energy to the birds comes at a log 9 CFU per kilogram. In this case, they are not different from the antimicrobial growth promoter in both trials. Then we proceeded with determining gut microbiota, key components of the gut microbiota composition with culture techniques. And in this, it has been shown that lactobacillus and bifidobacterium change with the probiotic inclusion level, and the significant change is recorded at the log 10 CFU per kilogram inclusion level. To proceed with a molecular technique which is called fluorescent in situ hybridization and determine all these components, we have shown that probiotic inclusion level is increased with the bifidobacterium increases with probiotic inclusion level, but we also noticed some gender effects. So you would expect that Clostridium histolyticum group, for example, is different between male and female broilers. The same, the Bacteroides fragilis group and Streptococcus SP difference with gender, which should make us consider about the applications that we are trying to have. Also in this study, the probiotic inclusion level changed the pattern of the volatile fatty acids with probiotics resulting in less acetate, less propionate, and higher butyrate as a molar ratio of the volatile fatty acids produced. Next study is the study with the live and the heat inactivated probiotic. This components were determined by real-time PCR. Regarding the probiotic, no probiotic, viable, inactivated, significant differences were also shown in the SICA for lactobacilli, for lactobacillus spe. But interestingly, we have also shown differences regarding the antimicrobial growth promoter, which resulted in a reduced lactobacillus sp and a reduced Clostridium perfringens subgroup in the SICA. Now, probiotics can also affect mucus layer thickness by increasing it, change the mucin glycosylation pattern in the SICA, not in the small intestine as Phytogenics did. So again, the question about link with autopathogenic function is highlighted. We need to know more about this. Effects on NUC2 gene, viable, is lower, it's reducing the gene expression of NUC2 gene in the ileum and more and higher reduction comparing to the control in the SICA. And finally, the study, we did study the gene expression of immune-related genes in the cecal tonsils of broilers. And we have seen that regarding the antimicrobial growth promoter, there is an anti-inflammatory effect by reduction of interferon gamma and the inducible nitric oxide synthase factor. Whereas regarding the treatments, all of them, apart from the control, had lower expression of ophinos, which is good news in the terms of anti-inflammatory management of the immune system. So, basically, as a conclusion, is that we start gather useful information about how phytogenics and probiotics can act in the gut ecosystem. Of course, there is a long way to go. We're just in the beginning. So for the time being, however, and until more knowledge will allow us to design more consistent and highly effective applications, we have to keep in mind that some of the factors that seem to play a particular role is the whole diet, the composition, and the inclusion level of the bioactive additive that we are using. And with this, I would like to acknowledge my students and my colleagues, and of course, Biomin for research funding. And I would like to thank you for your attention.
Just wondering why there was the gender difference in the microbiota.
That's a very good question, actually. Mm-hmm. A lot of reasons can be, we can think. For example, we know that there could be differences, for example, in the gut physiology between male and female birds. I mentioned in the introduction about the diet and host nutritional physiology. So supposedly that we have a faster moving digesta or not between the birds could play a role. Then it's the hormonal part, the neuronal part, and so on. So it's a lot of factors, but it is something that we would like to look further, because there are no reports, at least in the literature, as far as I'm aware of.
Other questions?
I have one anyway. The change in mucin 2 when you're using a probiotic, mm-hmm. is that a direct effect or an indirect effect, do you think?
Yeah, that's also a very good question. I mean, presumably, if we go back to the slide and look at this, This study is allowing us to make a better approach to the answer that we are seeking. When we have viable probiotic, we have a significant reduction comparing to the control, compared to the inactivated part. And this, as I said, difference becomes more obvious in the Sika, which, to my belief, this shows that we are talking about a direct effect, since when we have actively metabolizing bacteria, live bacteria in the gut, there is something going on that differentiates from only the cellular component that is not active but is present. So it should be more a direct rather than indirect effect.
Good. Time for the very last question. So a question from the moderator. You showed that some probiotics can prime the immune system. That is very interesting, this. All the probiotics are doing this, or just some of them are able to activate and prime the immune system?
Now, I think you're making the question, see if all probiotics are made equal. It's a very good question also. I mean, to be a probiotic, you have to have an effect on the immune system. The thing is, which probiotics do it better than others? There are three schools of probiotics. Let me allow the term school. It's the live bacteria, which is, for example, the lactobacillus, the bifidobacterium. It's the yeasts, the saccharomyces probiotics, and the bacillus ones. In monogastrics, we are using the first and third school, not so much yeasts. Therefore, I think that we have to look down to the species, to the strain level, to be able to extract this information that you are looking. For sure, they are not equal, okay? It's good to support the probiotic strategy as a means to replace antimicrobial growth promoters. But down the line, we have to make sure that the strains that we are picking to use have the right science and evidence behind the applications that we are aiming to do. And of course, they are safe, but to be a commercial product, it has to be safe one way or another.
Good. Okay. Thank you, Professor Mountzouris.